you are an amateur dracologist in the world of Wyrmspan, a place where dragons of all shapes, sizes, and colors roam the skies. Excavate a hidden labyrinth you recently unearthed on your land and entice these beautiful creatures to roost in the sanctuary of your caves. Dragons of all shapes, sizes, and colors? Is that how you describe a plethora of dragons? I feel like it could have gotten a little more.
I think my biggest qualm with the back of that so far is dracologist, which implies you have a degree in dragons, right? But dragons I typically think of ancient times or older, but yet they wouldn't have had like that title for a degree at that
point. Well, it's an amateur. You said you're an amateur dracologist.
Okay, so
you're a dragon fancier.
Okay.
You are a dragon fancier in the world of Wyrmspan, a place where dragons of many varieties, including scaly and smooth, roam the skies. There, I'll fix it for you. Me and Jake gotcha. They lay eggs, drink milk. Today on the board, boys.
Wyrmspan. Did you know a group of dragons is called a flight, a weir, or a wing?
I did not know that.
Or a thunder. I think it's because they're not real, so
yeah.
People just have called them whatever they wanted.
Well, dragons are real.
I prefer a thunder of dragons. But, I like that.
That's pretty sweet.
But there's not very many types. I know of Komodo. Those are dragons. That's their name. So they're dragons.
T-Rex?
I don't think that's a dragon.
Pterodactyl.
Is there a dinosaur with like the root word of dragon in the name?
Do you think dragons are like the ancestors of birds in the same way that dinosaurs are the ancestors of birds?
Or are they
reptilian? You certainly never see pictures of dragons with feathers. Although the front of this actually does kind of look like some feathers going on here.
Are we talking in like a fantasy setting or in a real world setting?
Well, I mean, I don't know.
If dragons were real.
If dragons were real, do you think they would be a separate entity as dinosaurs, which turned into birds?
Yes.
Are they the future of reptiles, or are they also in that same line that they're also birds?
I would say if you're going from a naturalist standpoint, I would think they'd be in the reptile line.
But
if you're going from a theological
right?
standpoint, it'd just be. Devils.
I want to toss something in here. So I just read a book that the baby dragons were feathered like birds and the adult dragons were scaled like reptiles. So there you go. They're both done.
Yeah.
What other species turn their type of, you know, the type of classification they are as they grow?
You know what?
Caterpillars.
Fun fact also, when we were talking about plural, I was just at a bookstore the other day and the person I was talking to said that multiple octopus are not octopi. That's incorrect. It is octopuses.
Yeah, I knew
because
that.
It's Greek and not Latin. I did not know that. I really thought octopi was real.
I mean, it can be.
speaking of...
octopi is when you cut a pizza into 8 slices instead of 6.
Speaking of octopuses...
I wasn't holding that one, too. I just want to point out that was off the dome.
That was a good wit. Speaking of octopuses, on Netflix, there's a documentary called My Octopus Teacher, and it is wonderful if you like that type of thing.
Have to check it out.
It's deeply depressing, but I love it.
Have any of you guys ever played that video game, Octodad, Dadliest Catch?
No.
It's Octodad. Yeah, it's a game where you're an octopus dressed up as a businessman, and you have to like make it through the grocery store and like stuff like that, and like do chores for like your family.
Imagine this. The only other person in this house that's played it besides Cam is my 10-year-old.
I've actually not ever played it, but I would really like to. Octodad, Dadliest Catch, I think is just a really funny name.
So do you guys subscribe to the dragons? They're generally like fairly intelligent and can speak, right?
Yeah, that's
like,
what I'm saying. That's
like in lore, like
yeah,
but not all.
But mostly, I think I don't know.
Like in Game of Thrones or Song of Ice and Fire, they don't.
That's
speak.
True. So there's like two tiers of dragons too, like the super
the D&D ones talk and
yeah,
can. Lord of the Rings they talk, right?
Yeah, I mean they can talk in a lot of different
Lord of the Rings
things.
They talk. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
I would say the standard for dragons is intelligence.
Yeah.
I think so too.
I would say that you're going off book. If the dragon can't talk.
So
although the real dragons in the world, Komodo dragons, cannot talk.
Yeah. that we know of.
So we were talking about, you know, levels of advancement amongst rats with First Rat and Rats of Wistar, and now we're talking about levels of advancement with dragons. Mm-hmm. So based on this argument, Song of Ice and Fire dragons are the Rats of Wistar, less developed rats. And then the other dragons we're talking about are First Rat, more developed rats, right?
Wait, you think the Rats of Wistar are less developed rats than the First Rat?
We had a whole debate about this. The First Rats went to space.
Well, no, they shot their rocket off.
Yeah.
We don't know where they went.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think the Rats of Wistar are much smarter based on the lore that we have for both of those games. The first of all, the First Rats think that the moon is literally made of cheese. So I don't think the Wistar Rats think that. Second of all, they made a rocket out of like rubber bands and like juice boxes. So
they
all channeled.
Like how are the like how are they gonna break the atmosphere with those kind of materials? It's just like untenable.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast. Season 14, episode 5. Tonight on the docket, Wyrmspan by Stonemaier Games. This is your board boy, Draconis Rob.
Bro. Draconis. Is that like a you're a professor?
Yeah.
Okay. Not a professor of dragons, TK.
I don't have a funny thing. I keep trying to think. I think too late. I'm board boy Jake.
And this is your boy, Dragon Force.
AKA, is that a band?
Yeah.
It's that band that did all those, like, it was like a cheesy, like, hair metal band that the shtick was like, they were all really ripping, like, long-haired, like, super good guitar player dudes, and like all their songs were like about dragons and like wanting to be
They're
around dragons.
Guitar Hero.
Yep, it's like the hardest song. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but like to be fair, they were excellent at what they were doing. Like that guy who had ripped those solos.
Just what they were doing was not excellent.
No, well, I mean, it was for what they were. Like I don't know how many people were like, Dragon Force is my favorite band. But I think a lot of people are like, Dragon Force is cool, you know? And like, they did come out in an era when people were really into novelty songs. Like, The Lonely Island was huge at that time. And just like a few years before, The Darkness did that one song that was huge. I Believe in a Thing Called Love. Which, The Darkness is more of a real band to me than Dragon Force, even though Dragon Force is probably actually, like, technically a better band.
Have you seen the singer from Darkness, like, streams, like,
no,
reactions.
No, seems like a cool guy.
Yeah, he's actually, like, seems like he's a pretty decent musician, so.
So, yeah.
Okay, quickly. Favorite dragon. Campbell, go.
Falcor.
Nice. My joke answer is Trogdor.
Trogdor is my favorite. Well, Trogdor, he's a dragon, man. He was just a dragon.
And my real answer is Smaug. Because
I think mine is Drogon from Song of Ice and Fire. The books, not the TV series.
I don't know that. Like, I don't have a favorite dragon.
Yeah, that's because we're men. I was being facetious.
T-Mat, there you go.
There you go. T-Mat's badass.
Okay, you do have a favorite dragon.
Yeah, I mean, like,
I just want to go on the record and say Falcor is not my favorite dragon.
Like,
nope, sorry. You picked him.
As a Final Fantasy guy, Bahamut was always
there's Bahamut. Dream. Bahamut's good.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of D&D dragons that are tight.
That's true. You know, speaking of joke songs, Trogdor the Burninator.
Yeah. Oh, man.
That's the most deadly serious song I've ever been.
All right, let's talk about board games we've been playing. I'll go first. I went to a Dealt Hand event and played in a Scout tournament.
Tight.
And we've already talked about Scouts. So I'm not going to really talk about that, but it was a really fun tournament. And in my first game, I taught some people. And if the game had not finished, it didn't finish because the tournament started, but I might have scored negative points in that game. I found out that I'm very bad at Scout. And the second time
You just found that out?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I feel like I used to be better at it.
No.
No, I've never been good. Have we ever played Scout together?
I don't know.
Anyway, the last time I played it, I think I scored 1 point. I don't know. It was bad. But there's a lot more depth to Scout than I think you originally looked like. You can definitely, instead of trying to play cards early, just sit there and build a hand and then just crush something out. I need to play it more to get better at it. That's not the game I want to talk about, though.
When you're building a hand, you run the gamut of someone might just crush out their hand and
right.
be
well,
done with you.
And it is also a table thing where, like, the table's not paying attention, they could let someone go out on accident. Right. Knowing when to like flip the like take and flip is a big deal too. Also, like just playing out the little stuff, you don't get points by people, you know, scouting off your thing. Anyway,
so was it single elimination or double elimination?
It was single. Basically, we played three. There were enough people for three tables, and then or four tables, and I think the winner of every table played at the final table. Okay. Was kind of how it went.
Okay, sounds fun.
So I got knocked out in the first round, but I got to then play with some people I'd met. They were very nice, and we played a game called Trellis. It is by Breaking Games. Designer is Teal Fristo. Artist is Vicky Chu. This is a real quick tile laying game where when you lay a tile, if you match the colors of the tiles of the vines, you can put down your tokens. And depending on how many you match, you can put down more tokens. And if you match somebody else's strand that's also going, they can put down a token. Like, if you see this sitting on the shelf, maybe give it a shot. It's 20 minutes long. I did not really enjoy it. I'm not a real big casual tile layer anyway. But the strategy behind, like, laying them down, like, that was, it's just not my type of game. It's a very pretty, like, cute little tile laying game, though, and it was really easy to pick up. But Trellis is just a one-boinger for me.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've played it on BGA, and I thought, like, the same thing. It was like, there's other tile laying games I would like to play.
I can go next. I have been traveling. Rob's cat is just licking himself in
Michael
a frenzy next
man.
To me. So
Michael's
that,
so cool.
That's possible you're going to hear that. I only have one game I want to talk about. I've done a lot of travel lately, but I've played this one several times. It's called Night, and it is by Radoslaw Ignatow. Artist is Micah Teglia. So it was a Kickstarter game that I backed, and it's print and play. I don't think the plan is to ever make an actual copy of it, but I could have that incorrect. But it is still available if you're interested. I think it's $5 for the basic files, and then if you do 11, you get all 11 of the different scenarios that exist for it. So in the description of this game, he wrote about it as, quote, his take on Hadrian's Wall. So it definitely has a similar vibe, and that was enough to have me be interested. So it is a game where there's quite a variety in how you set up. You choose a character card, and I think there are definitely over 10. Maybe there are 12 character cards. Then there's a court card that's the same in every game. It's like your main board, and then there's a scenario board as well. So you have three things in front of you. So I had Rob actually laminate all this for me, which is definitely the way to go if you're interested in getting this game. But what you do is, again, is really reminiscent on each turn to Hadrian's Wall. So there will be a card that flips, and essentially you're going to choose one of the two sides, and it's going to give you the resources you can use for the round. It's going to give you an action that you can use after you use all your resources. And then it has a consequence box, and that's a 1, a 2, or a 3. And so you spend your different resource points largely on the court card, but to some extent you could do it on the scenario as well. And then as you're doing that, you're unlocking different areas which provide you income or immediate boosts. Again, it's very reminiscent to the feel of Hadrian's Wall. Where it gets different is that main action that you take after spending your resources. That's definitely a different mechanism, and then the consequence angle is different as well. And so there's three different lines. The more you continue to choose the same line, the worse those consequences get. On the scenario board, there's a map, and depending on what the scenario is, it kind of changes what it is that's happening, whether it's a flood that you're pushing against or barbarians invading, but you're trying to mitigate what things that happen there. I think that I like it, although it really isn't what I was kind of hoping it was going to be. Whereas with Hadrian's Wall, you know, everything is really open to you, and you really can go and take different paths, and there's way too many things that you can't do everything in any given game. Because of the way the court card or the central one is organized, everything is really interconnected, and to get to any of the second or third levels of those buildings, you have to have done prerequisites that are other buildings. So it just kind of feels like that board is more or less always going to be the same. I think the thing that I maybe, I guess I've been the least impressed with. So there's a mechanism in the game that there are three or four different ways that you can win. And because of that, it every time that I've played this, which is 4 or 5 times now, I've just kind of aimed at one of them, and then the game has ended way earlier than the game would actually end. So there's supposed to be 12 different turns if you play it to its end, and then it's a did you obtain a certain amount of points. But otherwise, I've ended in like the 4th round, the 6th round, the 5th round, and it seems if you just kind of aim at one of those, the game just ends pretty prematurely. I really haven't had any difficulty winning any time yet, although I haven't played some of the ones that are categorized as the most difficult. But it is definitely a combo wombo where you're taking resources and turning into other things. You can cut each of your character card gives you individual goals to aim at, which can unlock additional resources that you can spend. There's a lot to like in that. I just don't think I necessarily like the way that it can so abruptly end that you've just won. And I think I don't know. So it's kind of similar, but in the opposite way. Like, one of the things I like the most about Twilight Struggle, which is a very different game, but there are several different ways to win that during the game, but it kind of becomes a mercy type thing in the game where you don't have to play the whole thing if it's clear somebody's going to win it, but that's just not the feel of this. Like, there's been games where I have been on the brink of losing, and I just angle that one win condition strong enough that I was able to win even though things were going really wrong. So it's definitely a game I want to continue to explore. It's, you know, if you laminate it, the setup is super easy, and just with a dry erase marker, you can erase everything. So again, it's available as a late pledge if you want to get the files and download them, and $5 is obviously a really low bar of entry, but that's Night, and it's something that I'm going to keep exploring, and I'll report back how my thoughts evolve as I play it more.
Sounds so cool.
Worse than Hadrian's Wall.
I definitely think it's worse than Hadrian's Wall, but Hadrian's Wall is a top 10 game for me, so it was always going to be worse than Hadrian's Wall. But I don't know. I'm curious to see how some of the hardest level of difficulty ones go.
It had a lot of components.
It does have a lot of components. So when I gave
a lot of sheets.
When I gave Rob all this stuff to laminate, I was like, man, this is a lot of stuff. So I tried to give him like really specific sticky notes of this many of this, and this is how many things
are here. It all worked out well. Did the stuff that was pre-cut work out okay
for
you?
Yep, absolutely. Yep, it was great. So,
quick thing. I just looked it up, but I was worried for a second. On the TV up there, they're showing it's March Madness, and they're showing a guy from Dayton named Daron Holmes II. And they had his name spelled capital D, small a, capital R, capital O, capital N. And I was like, that's crazy if that's for real. But I looked him up, and that's not how he uses the normal amount of capitals and smalls for a name that has 2 capital letters in it.
Are there any names that have 3 capital letters amongst them? I mean, 2 is pretty common in a surname, right?
Yeah. My surname has 2 capital letters.
But like, even when you get to like the Dutch, when like Van is in the middle. The Van's typically not capitalized, right? Because that could give you 3.
Or like a Van Der, yeah. So, yeah. And sometimes it's 2.
Wait, it's the Der that's not capitalized. The Van is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. Maybe. It's likely that that's happened. Tim, do you want to talk about what you've been playing, or should I?
I really only have one thing, and it is a beef.
Oh, okay. I have one thing, too.
I can give my beef right now.
Yeah, let's hear it.
And it's Michael, the cat.
Oh, Michael the cat.
Did such a terrible job recording the last episode that he's fired.
Like, oh, I didn't know you were going to beef with...
Yeah, I'm beefing with Michael. Like, he was in my seat, and then I got blamed for his...
Oh, that's true.
His terribleness. Like, this
who,
is...
Who blamed you, Rob?
I mean, all you guys.
I didn't...
All 3 of you pointed fingers at this chair, and Michael was sitting in it. And it was
I feel like I know I blamed him. I specifically put it in the notes.
Yeah.
That doesn't sound like me. I don't feel like I'm the blame game guy.
And then this time, this episode... He hopped up and just walked right over the keyboard. And you know what? It didn't stop the recording. I'm just saying. That's all I got. I haven't been
all right.
Much,
thank
so,
you, Michael.
Yeah.
Have I talked about Amalfi Renaissance at all on the podcast?
I think it was one of your 10 when you rattled them off.
Yeah. I've been playing it more. And I just want to say thank you to BJ for suggesting I play the game with him. And I think it's his nephew.
So this one, you gave it a thumbs down.
No, I don't think so. I don't think I would have given it.
Wasn't this one of your...
Originally, you did, I'm pretty sure.
Amalfi Renaissance? No, I don't think so.
Okay.
Somebody fact check us. Go back.
Yeah,
and
we can go back and listen. But like, I think I already found it interesting enough to have never do that. Because it's like, even if I didn't like the game, it's extremely unique. But I wanted to give it like a little bit more of a talk today. Because I've played it like 3 times now. It is one of the most interesting point salad worker placement games I think I've played. I still haven't figured out how to like actually be competent at it. Like BJ is really good at it. But essentially what you're doing is you have these little boats in like a harbor and they're your workers and you have to build more to get more kind of, the game that comes immediately to mind is, viticulture, right? How you have to like go build all the rest of your workers. You have to use resources to gain more boats over the course of the game. But basically every action you're either sending one of your boats to a worker placement spot where it stays the rest of the round, or you are like using your boats up in like bay areas or like these little like harbor areas to spend resources to get your boats back to like buy the things that get you points in the game. And so the way you gain resources in the game is like, let's say I have 6 boats remaining. I'll go send one of my boats to a worker placement spot that stays there forever. And maybe that worker placement spot says, send 2 boats to like wood resource. So you physically take 2 of your other workers and you like send them up into a spot on your board that's like a little harbor for wood. And it shows
on your personal board.
Yeah, on your personal board. And it shows that every boat there is worth 3 pieces of wood. So like, I think all of the resources are worth 3 and 1 is worth 2. But basically then, I can still use those boats to go to worker spaces like later in the round, but I have to spend the wood first to bring them back down into my bay. And there's like the reason that each...
You say spend the wood on doing other actions.
Yeah, doing other actions. So like the main thing you use wood for is like building more boats.
It's not that you have to spend it to get them back out of the bay.
Well, like, so basically when I move the boats out,
yeah,
that spends all the wood. So, like, if I have 2 boats up in wood and I pull them out, I use 6 wood. And whatever I'm using on that action is spent. So, like, I spend 4 wood, then I have 2 wood remaining, and that's converted into bread, which you use at the end of the round to feed people. And also it's used for other things you do. But the more I play it, the more fun it is, because it's kind of teletummy in, like, the interim scoring. So at the end of every round there's cards that like go over and like based on where they are and like how you draw them, it'll be like there's like little holes in the cards and it'll be like every this you have is worth 4+2 points, you know. And so like trying to get that end around thing. But then there's also there you have this huge hand of like helper cards that are kind of like Grand Austria Hotel helper cards, where some of them do like end of game stuff, some they do like passive abilities. Then there's like landmarks or like art that you buy that's like 3 different colors and it gives you tons of points. The more I play it, the more I'm like, man, it kind of takes scoring mechanisms and like game mechanisms from like all these different point salad games that I think are really fun. And I may go buy it because I don't know anybody who owns it physically. So very fun game. I would definitely plan on checking it out on BGA.
Hook me up, man.
If do you want to play a game on BGA?
Absolutely.
Let's get it going.
Yeah.
And one thing to note is I would read the rules if you're going to play it on BGA, because the teach video they have on there, it was difficult to figure out what I was doing. And it took me two full games to kind of like know what was up.
So if I don't read the rules or watch the video.
You can ask. I know how to play it now. So, but yeah, cool game. Amalfi Renaissance. Thank you, BJ. Oh, hey, one other thing from games. I don't know if I'm supposed to say this, but our boy, the designer of Pirates of Maracaibo, has a game in alpha on BGA. So it's very likely that one of our friends, one of our close friends, will be a BGA published fella after beta and into full release.
The game's tight too. It's fun.
It has no undo button.
Yeah, that's fine. I would say out of the
Yet.
3 games of his I've played, it is my second favorite.
It is definitely not. It's my third favorite, for sure.
Have you played the Orléans one?
Yeah.
Okay.
I love the Orléans.
Oh, you'll love
one.
The Orléans.
Yeah.
I've only played the Orléans one, so maybe I would feel the same way. I think it's cool. I think what it suffers from is it's just there's not quite as much going on as there is in like the other ones. Which is fine. It's fast, you know.
The Orléans one.
Yeah, the Orléans one,
fast.
And then
yeah.
And then but Pirates of Maracaibo is just such a good game.
It's great.
How can you be better than that? So
our Great Western Trail Japan roll and ride that we're gonna do with them is gonna be better.
Oh, that's a good idea. Cow herding in Japan.
Yeah.
Kobe beef.
Yep.
We really need to get on top of that.
I assume he's already done with it.
It's already half
done.
It's already
we'll be playtesting it next month. So,
I honestly, not to talk shop on the podcast, but we really need to approach Ryan with a Board Boys, Ryan Hendrickson, what's his name? Suchi role.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, there you go.
Like, he hasn't done any Suchi stuff yet, and we're all big Suchi fans.
Underwater City's rolling right.
I think there's already
a Woodcraft rolling right.
Yeah. I'm just not a Pulsar huge rolling right guy. Like, if you make my favorite game into a roll right, I don't know.
Okay.
We'll see.
How about not a rolling right? How about Underwater Cities, the dice game?
No
writing.
What if you like draft dice and you place dice instead of placing cards?
Yeah. I love drafting. I don't think there's enough good drafters out there.
Dice drafting rocks. I like dice drafting,
but I like drafting a lot too. Yeah. Like I love Bunny Kingdom, and Bunny Kingdom has like some of the most fun drafting in any game ever, you know?
It's a good one.
Yeah.
I have a couple to talk about still. One is Dune Imperium, the app. And we've already done a review on Dune Imperium. I am looking at it now. Did you guys know it's up to rank 6 overall?
Yes.
Whoa. Hey, really quick. It's the one you do for a roll and write for Suchi would definitely be Praga, for sure. That'd be a like really easy roll and write because you could have like walls all around the thing and just like cross them off when you build them. And anyway.
That'd be a good one. I think you should do Last Will, the roll and write.
We should do Last Will, Product of the Club, smash together the roll and write.
Well, so here's what you would actually do with Last Will is you would make a deck destruction game, like the opposite of a deck builder, because you'd be trying to make your deck smaller and smaller.
Dude, quit giving away all these ideas,
oh my gosh,
man.
All right, so Dune Imperium, Season 8, Episode 7.
Sorry, I interrupted Rob when he was about to talk about... Oh, Dune Imperium. There we go. My bad. I'm a step behind you guys.
Yeah.
So, Direwolf Digital, who is the publisher of the board game, is also a publisher of apps and video games. And they recently released the Dune Imperium app, which is just the base game of Dune Imperium. They also did the Root app, so my guess is you'll see more content.
At $72 each expansion.
Yeah, you know.
And if you want meeples instead of the squares on the board, it'll be another $47.
You know, I've come around on that a little bit. Like, app games originally were supposed to be cheap, but then a lot of them are trying to like microtransact, like sell you stuff anyway, or you can play them for free, or there's ad stuff in it. I mean, to pay for like a video game type experience, like $10 is not terrible.
But if you get all the Root stuff, it's like $40.
That's true. I mean, the expansions, it is kind of crazy, but...
Well, if you think about it, though, like I've played tons of Root. Yeah. Like... I'm making an announcement really quick. I updated my Legacy 10 a couple days ago to add Root. I've just played so much of it, and like I'm just convinced more and more that it's like a masterpiece. And I think about like how often I get to play Root with all the stuff for like a $40-ish price tag, and then like I play with Schlumbaum and Roth and Sen, and those guys all pay that, and so we've all paid like $160 to Direwolf to be able to do this all the time. And so, like, Direwolf is the makers of Root get money. That would be less than 4 all-in copies of the game for sure. But they still get, like, a pretty decent payout. And they don't have to, like, build anything physically. So, like, the cost of materials is nil. And the game was already designed. So it's really just the programming cost and, like, keeping the servers and whatever, you know. I think that's fair. And I think that if there were more games that I loved that had a dedicated app, I would use that. Like I love BGA for what it is, but like, what's the game that we like on the app that kind of sucks on BGA? Through the Ages, you know, is much better with an app, with like a native app experience.
That's
so
true. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Dominion app they released about a year ago. They re-released it with all the expansions, all everything. You know how much it is to get all of Dominion?
How much?
$162
on the app.
Yeah, if you want
on the app.
Yeah, so $162 for the Dominion app, but that is everything ever for. But the expansions are literally just cards.
Yeah. Well, and then like in the X in Donald X Vacherino refers to how many expansions are in Dominion.
I think it's more than that.
Yeah, it is, right?
Anyway, I just like to say that the implementation's really good. You can play asynchronously. They're going to have a bunch of looks like there's like challenges, like there's like weekly leaderboards. There's all kinds of crazy stuff in there. So they did a lot with it, and it's let me play the game more. And like, man, it reminded me of a couple small rules that I think I had forgotten existed. So I'm excited to get like the table version back again with the expansion stuff. Yeah, it's been fun.
I really like Dune Imperium. I like the way, like, we always compare it to Arnak because it came out at the same time and have similar mechanisms. I always liked the way Arnak plays. Like, I think it's like really smooth, and Dune Imperium can be a little more janky. But I think Dune Imperium is like a way smarter game in terms of like playing it over and over and over again, because you're competing. Like, there's the battles and like I don't know. It feels like maybe I just haven't played with the expansion. Even though it feels like there's a little less to do with the worker placement spots, the deck building I think is more fun, and the
well, and depending on what you play and what you say for your reveal,
yeah, exactly.
There's
yeah.
a lot of mm-hmm. different actions, and especially the expansions. There's a lot more stuff that like activate and you can do yeah. based on those things.
Yeah, I think it's more exciting, and like I feel like. If you get like stuck in, like you can like really like stop your progress in Arnak, and then somebody can run away with it. But like I feel like you can always kind of come back in Dune Imperium because there's so few points.
I like Dune Imperium. I do. I've always enjoyed my plays, but I am 100% the opposite. I like Arnak infinitely more. I just feel like in Dune Imperium, it so much comes down to whether you end up with the cards that give you bonus points that people don't know about. Like that, and that's one. If you get just you happen to draw a card that gives you a point, that's 10% of what you need to do in the game. Like. Yeah. Arnak, there's nothing that's hidden like that. It's just maximizing what's in front of everybody.
It's true.
I love both. I really love both games. So
I mean, Arnak is more of a solo experience, and Dune is more of a
sure.
combating multiplayer sure. experience, really. And one thing, I'm not usually a huge fan of games where like you score 10 points. Like, but in this one, it's interesting, and fighting for those is cool. If you haven't tried it yet, I have Dune Uprising. And I like it more, even though people, you have to, you can't ignore the sandworms because they make fighting like crazier. So if like you let one person do sandworms and nobody else does sandworms, you're just going to lose. But in the couple of games I played of that, everyone scored over 10 points because there's just so many more ways to score points in general. And I find that interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I like I said, I really do like the game. I just... Arnak appeals a lot more to me, which is funny, though, because you mentioned not necessarily loving games you score so few points. That's generally something I really like about games.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I guess maybe if I played Dune Imperium more. But it's just like there's too much that can happen that you just can't know is going to happen. And that, like, just from the flipping the treachery cards that let you add, like, yeah. fighting in the end. And I don't know. I do really enjoy the game. I would rank it highly, but Arnak is probably a top 10 game for me as well.
Yeah, I used to be more of an Arnak person. I can't tell you now because I've been playing a lot of Dune Imperium lately because of the app, and they're both so good.
Great designs.
I wish there was an Arnak app.
Yeah, same. Hey, do you guys want to hear my updated Legacy top 10? Because I just have it
people
right
have
here.
Been requesting that we make an episode about that. Maybe we should hold that and actually.
I just want to rip it real quick though, so, because what if we forget?
We won't forget.
We've had a lot of inner feedback on Discord mentioning that. Save it.
Okay. All right. Okay. I don't want to, but I will.
We'll do it. You know what? We'll do it the next episode. Campbell's on.
Yeah, I'm gonna miss the next episode.
Instead of our game discussion, maybe we'll just rip our top 10.
Let's do it.
Yeah. I feel like I've become very omni. Like there's euros have gone out and cash and party and dudes on a map games have gone in.
How many, real quick prediction? How many universals do you think there'll be? Any?
How many matches?
So that every single all four of us have. Will there be a single game that is on all four of us?
I mean, I think there's several three, games. Yeah, yeah.
But
I think you and I will have one other game at least overlap.
I bet none of us all match on all four.
Like, you don't think there's a single game that all four of us will say?
Nope.
I don't.
Let me look at my list here. And
I think there will be multiple ones that maybe three of us match up on.
Mm-hmm. I think that'll happen a lot. I think who will have the most that it's that game is the only one on their list?
You.
I think so.
I think it'll be you as well.
I think so too.
Yeah.
I think I'll be close. I think I will also have.
We
a
should.
Lot of...
This should be a thing on Discord. We like do a tournament of we make predictions, prop bets for things that are going to happen.
Okay, I see one game that I think well, but I don't know if you love it. So,
all right, save it for the cast.
I think it's possible that one game hits because I think I have three games on here that I think could be on any of your guys' lists, but I don't think that all of them will be, but I do think I only have probably, I think I probably have three games that will not be on anybody else's list for sure.
I think half my list will not be on anybody else's list.
Okay, I just have one more game I want to hit. It is Turing Machine.
Oh, I wanted to talk about that today too, but then I thought we were running
by
out of time. That's
Fabian
great,
Griddle and Johan Levitt, and this is by Scorpion Mask, which might be my favorite. Casual kind of game company.
Yeah, because they're also Stay Cool too.
Yeah,
right?
They
which
crank
is really
out
fun.
Some. They crank out some weird, different, fun games. They also do the Zombie Kids games too. And Turing Machine, this is straight up deduction. I always thought it looked cool. I thought it looked kind of overly complicated and hard to teach from what I was reading. It was on BGA. You could play it solo. I highly recommend going and checking it out on BGA. It's a fantastic implementation, and that's how I learned it. After playing a bunch of it on there, I decided to pick up the physical copy, and I really like it. So basically, I don't know how they did this, but every round you pick three numbers, and you grab these little punch cards for each number, and then you overlay them on top of each other, and then there's 4 to 6 different machines, depending on your difficulty, that you check them against. So it might be like... Is yellow greater than, less than, or equal to 4? And if you're yellow, the yellow number you pick was, let's say, 3, and you test it, and it says yes, then you know that yellow is less than 4 because that's what you were testing. And then there's a lot of that. And so then it's got a little sheet, a little Heidi divider thing, and you mark down the stuff. And then every round you can ask 3 questions, and then at the end of the round everyone can be like, yo, I want to guess, or no, I don't. And then the tiebreaker is, like, if there's a round where you only need to ask one question and somebody had to ask 2, then you would win, you know, if they both got it right. But if you all get it right in the same amount, I think it's just a tie game. Really think it's fun. Game's about 20 minutes long. The only thing I don't like about the physical version is it's the same problem Awkward Guests has, only that it's not as bad. But you have to go through and find... every single tester card and then the correct test cards as well. So basically between 8 and 12 different cards you got to pull out of the decks and set the game up and then put them back in like the order, the numeric order, so it's easy to find them again. So like playing it multiple times in a row is slightly annoying because you got to completely reset the thing up. But other than that, I really like it.
It's so fun. There's been some drama on BGA though. They cut out turn-based and arena for it, right?
Well, somebody made like a cheater app that you can
like
just,
a solver, yeah.
And yeah, so, like an online solver where you
then,
can just.
And then step two is like a Russian guy learned about it, and then
yeah, like what's the point of playing a game if you're just gonna like input it and do it? It's like playing Words with Friends and then going to the website that tells you like the best word to play.
I'm not saying that all board game arena cheaters are from Russia, but I will say that it is a disproportionate amount.
It's because most of them decide to play with little buzzers in their butt.
Yeah, well, that, well
you hear about
that
Russian chess player?
No, that guy's not Russian. He's American.
No, or is it an American chess player?
I think he's an American chess player. I think so. But the butt buzzer hasn't been confirmed, but I think that guy did get a butt beeper. That's the theory. The running theory is that this kid who... has admitted to cheating in the past, but said he wasn't cheating. He's like ranked like 98 or something like that, and he played like against like the rank 2 guy or rank 1 guy, and beat him. And he like made such a glow up in short time that like a lot of people think he was cheating, and they think the way he was cheating was that he was getting chess tips from like an AI, and it would like buzz. He stuck like a pager up his butt, and it would like buzz him like in Morse code where the movie needed to make. which is so funny. But I do think that, like, I think that it must be, like, part of Russian culture where, like, it's okay to cheat if you're good at it.
Yeah, to win.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of like how, like, in South American soccer, it's like you're, like, allowed to, like, punch the ball into the goal if the referee doesn't notice.
Yeah, yeah.
Or, like, bite a guy's ear off if the referee doesn't notice.
All right, Mike Tyson.
No, no, like, that's not a Mike Tyson. That's a Suarez, man. That dude from, like, Uruguay or whatever.
Did he do it before Mike Tyson?
It was after.
Right, okay. But yeah. I'm,
they
but
call
like
him the vampire.
Yeah.
Has he done it more than once?
Yes.
He's done it a lot of times.
Oh, okay.
He has been a lot more ears than Mike Tyson.
Gotcha. All right, well, tonight on the podcast, we played Wyrmspan by Stonemaier Games. It re-implements Wingspan, kind of, I guess. It is 8.1 on BoardGameGeek. It is currently 1,075 overall, 575 strategy, and 233 family. 1 to 5 players, best at 3, 90 minutes to play. 2.65 out of 5 for the weight. Ages 14 plus. They decided not to get it kid tested for younger ages, I guess, because I don't think you need to be 14 to play this game. Designer is Connie Vogelman, and the artist is Clementine Campardo. Connie Vogelman is the same designer that did Apiary.
I find it strange that Hargrave got a developer credit on this and not a designer credit, because I don't think I've ever seen like a spinoff game that didn't at least nominally include the original designer with a designer cred.
Yes, I would agree with
well,
that.
My guess That's is I'm weird. Pretty sure she designed it and then brought it to Stonemaier's, like, hey, check this out, and they probably brought in
right,
Elizabeth.
But to like,
and,
yeah. but to like to with like My Little Scythe, did Stegmaier take a credit on that, or like? I mean, like, I don't know anything about the industry, but I think that, like, every time I've seen a game that didn't seem like it was designed at all by the original designer, they still get a designer cred, which is maybe Stegmaier's trying something new here with the developer credit. They're going to have to add a whole new section on BGG. Games developed.
Yeah.
I mean, the designer on My Little Scythe was Hobie and Vienna Chow, so.
So maybe this is just Steg's thing. Maybe if you Stegmaier game, he is. Or a Stonemaier game. That's just the way they do things over at SMG.
Yeah, so in Wyrmspan, you're playing over 4 rounds. You are digging out caves. You are playing or enticing dragons to come live in your caves. You're exploring the caves. And, I mean, those are the 3 things you do. You're trying to find the most combos, lay the most eggs, tuck the most cards, cash the most resources. There is a new dragon guild track that when you get that symbol, you can kind of run around there and get resources from that. You can also get some end game scoring things from that. There are also end of round objectives to meet. Man, that's a pretty easy rundown for a game. Especially if you played Wingspan, you're 80% of the way there to being able to play Wyrmspan. So why don't we get to the table and come back with our thoughts on Wyrmspan.
Nice.
This is a difficult subject about something that's crazy or overhead. They know they have something that people don't like, and they still continue to disrespect. The thing I'm talking about is an essence, a foreign fragrance with a presence that you can't see with the naked eye, but to the nose, it's a nuisance. It comes in so many forms, it's camouflage, and it will sneak up upon you like espionage. You might not know it, cause it won't show it, and you will swear it's just a mirage. It could be with you when you're talking. It will be so close, your vic is hawking. What a bit of a twang, it got its own slang, it's even known in New Yorkin'. Everybody know what I'm saying, from here to the Himalayan. If you don't know, you must be doodoo. This is what I'm saying about the dragon. About the dragon. About the dragon. About the dragon. I think I should go more into depth.
And we're back.
That is
Campbell? Wyrmspan, your first play, what do you think?
I was going in, because I heard everybody say, oh, this is so much better than Wyrmspan. I feel like everybody I've heard said that. So I was like feeling a little...
like you wanted to go against it?
I'd be like, this is every hot game all over again. But I will say my initial impression, there were things I liked more about... I think the things I like more about Wyrmspan outweigh the things I like better about Wyrmspan. But we can get into that when we get to pros and cons.
So I'm going to kind of do a similar thing and say that my thoughts going into my first play were that I wasn't really going to like this very much because it just felt to me like an expansion to Wyrmspan. Again, not knowing a ton about it. I mean, I guess the fact that 80% of it is probably Wyrmspan. I left my first play very pleasantly surprised, and I guess one of the things that we'll probably say in pros, though, I felt like there weren't turns that I hated myself, like happened in Wyrmspan a lot. So that was my first take.
Yeah, I'm not really sure what I feel on my first... I've played it twice. Both times felt very long, and I'll probably just leave it at that, and I don't know. It's been fine.
We played five the first time.
We did play five the first time.
We played four tonight.
This time, yeah.
Yeah.
So...
For me, I saw it was coming out, and I really had no interest in it at all, I don't think, originally. I don't know why all of a sudden I decided,
dude,
hey,
you have
dragons.
FOMO. Maybe, more than anybody that I know. Like the second there's cool pictures popping up, you're like, I'm gonna buy it.
Yeah. You know, I pre-ordered it before that though, I think.
Did you? Okay.
Yeah. No, you know what? Maybe I was in this one at the beginning. Expedition was the one I waited on Expeditions for a while. This one I just figured we're probably gonna review it anyway, so I'll just get it.
If I ever want you to like get something, I just send you pictures of it.
Yeah, there you go.
Like, hey, check this out.
I heard this one's really good.
Yeah, I heard this is really awesome. Everybody really likes this.
Hey, you know, I definitely have passed. There's been a lot of Kickstarter stuff lately, and I've definitely passed on some stuff and let other people get it.
You were supposed to do that with Inferno, and then you ended up getting Inferno. Anyways.
That one looks too cool. Yeah.
Yeah, you should.
That's cool. So for pros for Wyrmspan, I really like the caves. That is something new in this one. It is a way to get resources and or get cheaper free actions. And there's a bunch of different ones, and they're cool. And you can put them anywhere because they're not like color dependent on the cave they go in. The caves are all differently colored, but that's just for aesthetic purposes only.
So basically, conjunction to Wyrmspan, you have to lay out a card to open up the next spot in your habitat.
Yeah, there's like three pre-printed caves. I guess you guys didn't see them because I probably didn't hand them out, but there are like Stonemeyer's. Well, first of all, there's cards that kind of explain like the actions and stuff, even though that's right on the board too. Mm-hmm. But there's also a card that says like, here's your like first couple of turns and what you should do, just kind of like they do in Scythe. And it's put a cave down and build a dragon. Because you start with certain resources and you get to pick those. So those are things right off the bat you can kind of just get going. You don't got to sit there spending turns churning your wheels to get stuff. You can immediately start putting stuff on your board. And caves are free until you get to the third and fourth row where you got to pay extra eggs for them.
And that replaced in Wyrmspan, obviously, just as you play birds further, you need to pay the cost of the birds plus eggs. So they kind of broke that up and that the egg cost comes from the caverns or the caves.
Yep.
And then the resources still come from the dragons. I think my biggest pro with this game is getting resources in Wyrmspan just always feels terrible, especially when you don't have a fun tableau built up on that one. But I also think that's like the worst action to have to keep running all the time. And because you get a lot of your resources from either playing things down or from exploring the caves, which is fun, and you can kind of build some neat little systems there. But it feels so much better to have to do that necessary component than it does in Wyrmspan.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Because you have to pull it out of the dice, is that what you don't like about it? Or,
well, yeah, because one, you can't really necessarily guarantee what you're going to get with the dice tower and the things being there. And how I feel like everybody can relate to a Wyrmspan game where you've wanted resources, but nobody wants the resources that are sitting there, and you just have to continue to wait because you don't want to take something that's suboptimal until they've been re-rolled.
No,
and, like,
I just take them.
You just take them?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, I feel that all the time.
I mean, every two resources is a resource in that game too, right? Yeah. So that shares the same thing here. Although I don't know that I ever have ever, I don't think I've ever paid two resources for one resource in Wyrmspan. I don't think I've ever had to, just because you get to pick what you want.
I think that the egg management in Wyrmspan is much more interesting than the egg management in Wingspan, just because the dragons hold fewer eggs. They're used for more purposes, such as building. Some of the dragons require egg payment. A lot of the costs on like the action cards, but like pay, like Wingspan does that some, where it's like discard an egg to draw two cards or whatever. But I felt like it was a lot more meaningful in this. So that was fun for me. Like,
Cam, I think the dragons hold just about as many eggs.
Oh,
I think,
do they? Maybe I just had low dragon.
I think it's just because you took a bunch of baby dragons. Yeah.
But still, like, when you create eggs and when you spend eggs, I thought was more frequent.
Yeah.
Than in Wingspan, which I thought was fun.
But the dragon, just to talk about the hatchlings, I think those are cool too. They're kind of like their own unique thing where we talk about, like, when you're exploring the cave, you get to stop on your board every place that there is a little explorer guy. And then your dragons can also have an explorer guy on them too. So you can really kind of build your own tableau for exploring those caves. And the wyrmlings do something, or the dragonlings do something kind of interesting where they let you cash a resource on them, and then if you cash a resource, you get to do a thing, and then if you do a thing, I guess they don't all cash resources. Basically,
or tuck cards.
Yeah, you all get to do a thing, and then if you do it, you get to do a different thing, and then the third time you do that thing, you get a thing.
Well, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you get a bonus.
Yeah, you get like an extra bonus. Mm-hmm. So I think those guys are cool. So Cam had like a really neat one going on his bottom row.
Yeah, I had a really cool combo down there.
I just think, kind of building back to what I said before, it's just like the main actions in Wingspan of getting food, laying eggs, drawing a card, just on their own, there's nothing enjoyable about doing any of those three things. Like, if you build cool tableaus, then it's fun to run through everything. But just like doing the exploration thing, because you're getting a variety of things anyways, plus whatever dragons you play, they all feel better to me. I don't know if that's something the rest of you kind of agree with, but I don't know. I guess I had a couple turns in this game that we played here where I had to just take a base exploration action where I only got one thing, and that didn't feel good. But I just feel like that happens so much less often in this game than
Wingspan. I agree with that too. I like the fact that your actions are the coins and they're a resource, because you can gain extra ones and you can spend extra ones as well. Some dragons cost an extra coin to play.
I think that's a very enjoyable aspect of this game, that you can do things to add more turns, and you can find ways to kind of wobble your way into extra actions, which is not something that you can do in Wingspan.
Yeah, and like the actions are like, I feel like giving up an action to take a better action is a lot of times preferable in this, whereas I don't know how often I'd want to do that in Wingspan. So that's that, you know, I had a fun time with the coins.
Yeah, some dragons cost coins.
Yeah.
Which, mm-hmm. You got to weigh that too, right? So.
Yeah. And then, like, one of the dragon cards I had would let me pay a coin to get, like, a huge windfall of, like, cool stuff. And it's like, well, I'm taking an extra action to do this, but it's pretty strong. So, I don't know. I thought that was really fun.
So, we didn't really talk about the Dragon Guild. The Dragon Guild's a separate board in the middle. It's you just kind of move your thing. It's in a circle. It lets you gain resources. And for me, two kind of opponents. You get cards in caves without having to run your little, cave explorer, which is very nice and can come in very handy. And then the top and the bottom of the track is, or I guess the circle, is like a middle board where you can put a little marker. I assume they're cubes in the regular.
Yep.
Yeah. You put a little marker on there, and they have different things for different games. Usually there's an end game scoring.
Yeah, there's always an end game scoring. The bottom end game is, there's always like
points.
There's always points at the bottom, and there's always a different end game thing, and there's always like three or four other options up above. There's four of them in the box, and they're double sided for either two or three players or four or five players. So there is some variability with that as well. I really dig the dragon board. I think it's fun going around there. It's one way you can always get a coin. It's towards the end of the circle.
Right.
I think you can get everything in the game from going around that circle. Like all the resources are there, a card, cave, coin, egg. Those are all choices as you're going.
Yep. Yeah. I like it. It's a an interesting mechanism to, I don't know, help you kind of break up the monotony of the rest of the game.
And that's a fun way to wobble into the things you need to. Like if you're not getting something you want, but you can move on the track, you're near something. Plus, I think that it's great for longevity that there's multiple options that exist there. And it is the fun push and pull of, do I take a really powerful action that doesn't necessarily give me any endgame points, or do I start aligning to where the endgame can come? So, or endgame points are going to come from. So I think that's fun. Usually that's always a good mechanism in games to make people make that decision.
Yeah, I found myself during the game wishing that I could, like, spend something to, like, move an extra space on it when I got a move, because there would be, like, something I didn't want. But, like, with the rewards, like, on that center board being spaced where they are, that'd be kind of hard to do and still, like, not have somebody just exploit that to go throw, like, tons of cubes on that center board. Although, there's only so many you can do before the end of the game, but I don't know. I think it works great the way it is. Even though I was a little sad about, like, I don't want a cave card right now. And that's going to, like, you know, I'm going to have to wait till a whole nother turn to get the gem that I want. Or I want a milk from it. But that's literally the second to last thing on the circle. I don't know. It was cool. I thought it was real cool.
Yeah, I think going back to what Jake said earlier about things feel something more satisfying, I think there's just more ways to get what you want. And like, just because of the Dragon Guild or the cards or the caves, or just that little bit of extra stuff they added to let you wobble into the stuff you need is great. Instead of having to rely on taking like the three main actions to do the thing you want to do.
I like that they ripped out all the stuff that makes Wyrmspan annoying. Like the roll all the dice in the bird feeder cards and the once per turn when somebody does this card, like those cards like are cool in Wyrmspan, but they just make the game take so much longer, and things people do where it's like, okay, this action, now I get to take a resource and you get to take a resource and you get to take a resource, and like they just lengthen the game, and they're like,
well, especially in this case, because when it's other people get to take a resource, because there are those helpful dragons that do a similar thing, but it's just the universal resource sign, everybody can just take whatever they want.
It's
and
just
they're not
fast,
dependent on the pool that's sitting there, and, oh, I got to reroll now, and being strategic about, do I take this worm, because then the next person gets to reroll it. Like, there's none of that, which speeds it up exponentially, I think.
Yeah. Like, we got through this game, and, like, was I the only one playing it for the first time?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But we got through it in what, like hour and a half?
What is not base amongst what you have here? Or is everything base? Because the components are awesome. Like the...
Yeah, I bought the nicer component pack that Stonemeyer sells. So the wooden resources and the metal coins.
Okay.
Otherwise, those are all cardboard. The markers are cubes. There's a wooden explorer and a wooden guild shield. I 3D printed all those off of Thingiverse because I made like little dragon meeple guys instead of the cubes. But I mean, overall, like it comes with all those cards. There's a bunch of cards in there. But like the resource pack wasn't that expensive. I think it was like $20 or something like that. So,
you know, I guess we haven't necessarily talked about all the ways that it's similar to Wyrmspan, other than the fact that we said it's about 80%, but there's an end game, or sorry, an end round, four rounds is Wyrmspan 2, right? There's four rounds, or five rounds in Wyrmspan?
I think there's four.
I think there's five.
Five? It's been a hot minute since I played it.
Yeah, but also there, you know, it has goals that are variable and are going to change from game to game. I really like that in this game, when you score one of those goals, you're not losing an action, which is completely necessary in Wyrmspan, because as your tableaus get bigger, it just increases the length of the game. So I think that's needed to make Wyrmspan not be just crazy long at the end. But I also like that you don't have to go into this game knowing you're going to get less actions each round. But other than that, again, a lot of the core things that you're doing are really similar. Just the ways you do them are I guess different, and that's what
really there's still like three areas to play your dragons. Like there's three areas to play your birds. The top one is when you explore the top cave, that's the resource area. When you explore the middle cave, that's how you're going to get cards. And how you do the bottom one is where you're going to get caves. And because wasn't one of the Wyrmspan areas like laying eggs?
Yep.
Since there's no actual way to lay eggs natively in the game, at the beginning of every round, they do let you get an egg, which I think is a fairly important thing, especially if you're not getting any other ways to gain eggs because some things cost eggs. At least they give you one at the beginning of the round. So I think that's pretty neat as well. I never really thought about that until just like halfway through this game where I'm like, I'm not generating like any eggs. I'm like, well, at least I get the one at the beginning of the round. Then by the end of the like third round, I was making all kinds of eggs. But early on, that was an important factor. I think we've covered most everything, right, guys?
I think so.
Similarities, pros.
Do you want to talk about the solo? Because I know you've done that.
Oh, yeah. This game rocks. I can't remember if I've ever played Wyrmspan solo, so I don't know how similar it is. It's got to be pretty similar, though. It's literally one of the easiest solos I've ever done. You flip a card, and based on the card you flip, you move a marker around the Dragon Guild for an opponent, and then they just gather stuff as they go. It's super easy to do. I've played it a couple of times. If you like solo, this is a fantastic solo game. Cons for me, there's no dragon facts on the bottom of the dragon cards. My favorite thing about Wyrmspan literally is the fact that I'm learning about birds as I'm playing. And like, I don't know, I'm a big theme guy. So like when I play a bird, I'm like, hey, did you know that the Asian condor can blah, 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 blah. Like, I don't know. People maybe hate me for that, but I like to educate as we're playing games.
There's an app, too, that Wyrmspan where you play the bird, and it'll make the sound of the bird. Isn't that a thing, too? I think my brother-in-law is big into that.
Oh, that's cool.
So whatever bird it is, you put that in there, and it makes the sound, which is, I mean, it's like a novelty that's fun, like one or two times.
Then you get the bird call going.
Yep.
Bonus points if you can do the bird call of the bird you play.
I'm not a big, like, dragon guy. Like, dragons are, like, whatever for me.
Good thing these are worms.
And then like the birds of Wyrmspan, like that's to me that's like a really cool, unique, like they like Wyrmspan was such a cool, like unique like idea that everybody initially thought, oh, who cares about that? But then they play and they oh, this is really cool, and then all these bird games came out that are all much less good. Well, some are pretty good, but you know,
I like Birdwatcher more than I like Wyrmspan.
Yeah, you know what? It's fine. That's okay. I have nothing bad to say about that. but I just like the bird art better than the dragon art. I like real stuff. I don't care about fiction. I like reading biographies. I don't like reading detective stories. I'm just joking. Fiction is fine, but I think I just like the overall art in Wyrmspan better, but that doesn't have a whole lot to do with whether I like a game more, but that is, I mean, that's the one thing I noticed immediately. I also like the material of the eggs in Wyrmspan better than the material of the eggs in this game.
I think the new Wyrmspan eggs are like these eggs.
Ooh, that's too bad. The original Wyrmspan eggs are the bomb.
Because they're like a more of like a plasticky thing. I think for a sustainable thing, yeah. Like they went more wood. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I miss the goal cards of Wyrmspan where you get the you know your bonus scoring that you can gain and
oh,
get
the personal
points that way.
Goals.
Yep, and that are you know often related to like the names of the birds or where they're from or
I think
things
those
of
are
that nature.
Cool.
I miss those and I really enjoy on Wyrmspan 2 where it tells you what percentage of the you know the cards are that so you can make those decisions.
They're never
but
worth that many points, but they're
not,
fun.
Not crazy.
They're fun, yeah.
But I it's just something extra to strive for. Now correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm sure there's enough Wyrmspan expansions that this probably does exist, but are there as many birds in Wyrmspan that give you endgame scoring conditions like the dragons do in this game?
I don't remember.
I don't remember that either, and I do like that about this, that there are dragons that, based on the dragons they're touching or where they are in the row, you get points. So that kind of replicates that, but I still just kind of miss having those
I think
cards.
I feel like there's more in this. I don't remember if there's endgame scoring birds in Wyrmspan at all.
I just don't. I think I've only played one of the expansion decks, so I don't really know. That's probably something they added as they went through, but I don't know that, but that does exist here, but it does not make me not miss those bonus scoring cards.
Yeah, I mean, there's the red ones are other players, and the blue ones might be the end game ones. I don't remember. It's been a long time. The brown ones are the ones that you do every time.
Oh, you're right. So there are.
I think the blue ones are actually you score them in the like they're like the stopwatches. You score them in the middle of the rounds.
That's true.
I'm pretty sure that's what it is.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, that's kind of like the cons that I would have for it as well. Like but the end game scoring card, like I don't know why they didn't just like give you a deck of those. Maybe cost wise.
Well, I mean,
or maybe just one more thing you didn't need to score. I don't know.
There's a bunch of end game scoring on the dragons.
Yeah, I know, but like there's that in Wyrmspan too, though, we're saying, right?
I don't think there is endgame scoring birds. I think you just go get you draw the cards.
Okay. Well,
what do you mean?
I'm pretty sure.
Oh, you're right. You just draw the bonus.
You just draw the bonus cards. Yeah. Or you talk or whatever it is, right?
Yeah.
You're right. Maybe that's what the difference is.
Yeah.
Was this what you were just saying, that there's not a pact like to write the scores down? But I know you use the BGG.
No, there's a score sheet.
Oh, there is. Okay. I was going to say, that's weird that doesn't exist.
I've just never used the score sheet because BG Stats has the score sheet in it. You're right. I don't think there are. So yeah. I think I actually like the scoring on the dragons better than the scoring on the secret cards.
I don't know. I kind of like just the collecting different things, though. It adds an extra layer of what type of bird you're collecting, or, you know, collect birds that eat this resource. I don't know.
I was doing that. I had a dragon that was like, for every set of different dragons I had, I got 4 points.
Yeah.
For me, it's the same. Like, they're both wildly random.
Yeah.
Like, I've played plenty of games at Wyrmspan where I have a scoring card and those cards just don't come around with 10% of the deck or whatever it is. Like, it felt like the same way here, where like, or when they do come around, you don't get them because you can't draw a card or whatever it is. I don't really love this game very much at all. It feels, for me, incredibly long. Like, the time between your turns can be,
way better than Wyrmspan in that regard, right?
I don't think it's better.
Nothing takes as long.
Dude, there was 20-minute times between. It was like, I would take a 30-second turn. It would be, I could have gone and played another game and by myself and come back and be like, oh, okay, cool, it's my turn again. Like,
man, I didn't feel that at
all
today.
Yeah, but you were playing with me, so.
Like, it might have been this half of the table, but like, dude, you guys both took some pretty long turns, and then that fire player game was, like, obnoxious. Like, I could not.
That could definitely be a con. I mean, I noticed a little bit of that as well, and that's just how
there's some wobble
this game
here.
Can go down.
Yeah, and it
I
just,
must have forgot my heart medicine today. I was playing for the first time, which is never helpful.
It's just like it for me. It feels way longer than it takes, and for me, it takes too long.
Yeah, I mean, this game, it says we played it. I feel like it was probably closer to 2 hours.
Yep, I agree with that.
The BGG says 90 minutes, and I think if it was 60 to 90 minutes, that's right where this should be at.
Yeah.
I bust out a solo game of this in like 20 minutes.
Like, and I wouldn't say that we're slow players.
No.
So, like, playing with slow players at 5 players would be.
This is not a 5-player game. Like, still in my quit making games up to that many players.
Yeah. I think that's my biggest gripe. Other than that, like, I just don't think it's fun. Like, I don't know. The cave exploring's good if you can get it going. Other than that, like, I don't know. Like, it just doesn't feel very fun. And you have to crest the hill. And if you don't, like, it's not fun. Does that make sense? Like you filled your board, right?
That was
like,
one dragon short.
Yeah, like you can do everything you need to do if you get over the hump. Other than that, it's just like, I don't know. You know?
I mean, I was only 13 points behind Rob, and I only had 7 dragons, too, so.
Yeah. But, like, I don't know. It just feels like you just don't get there, and you just kind of spin your wheels, and you're, I don't know. I think Wyrmspan's the same way.
Yeah. So there's just to jump back, and I do have one more pro that you made me think of is I never do well in Wyrmspan. Like, you see all these people where, like, they've made these crazy engines. In this one, I don't think I think you could do it either way. Like, you could make a real cool engine, but you can also just build out your entire board and get a lot of points that way and still do good. Like, that's how I prefer to play it.
Yeah, but you had I believe you built an engine to do that.
Yeah, but I didn't have, like, 30 eggs you know.
But your,
like,
engine was getting cards out.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, okay. Yeah. I get that, but, like, that's fair.
Yeah. That makes sense. Like,
but, like, maybe that's the engine I like to build, I guess. Like, how do I build out my board?
Getting more resources,
getting more cards down. Not I'm going to run this bottom row 50 times.
And tuck cards.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
We interrupt this programming to bring you some important messages.
All right. Hey, everybody. We have a special guest here to talk about, you know, kind of maybe in the middle, at the end of our Wyrmspan episode, but we got Joe from the Deltan. We thought we would have him on to talk about, one, Camp Refresh, which is going to be April 25th through the
26th, 27th, 28th.
The end of April. And get your thoughts on Wyrmspan. So why don't we start with that? Joe, why don't you give us a little bit of rundown of how many times you played Wyrmspan, what your experience with the with Wyrmspan is, and then we'll talk about, you know, your thoughts on Wyrmspan.
Absolutely. So Wyrmspan was one of those games that we got early. And so we had a fair amount of folks coming through our events just because we had it, because you couldn't find it for a long time. And so there are a lot of folks who were, it was the first time we really had a lot of like specific requests. Hey, I want this game. Can you make sure that I've got this game available when we get here? So it's not a thing that we do a ton of, but it was at our events. Should I talk about who the dealt hand is?
Probably.
Okay. All right. So the Dealt Hand, we are a hosted game event company, so we do pop-up game nights at bars and restaurants. We also do statewide library programming. When we pre-COVID, Wyrmspan was one of the first like real like heavily requested games that we had, so people wanting us to teach them how to play or just wanting to check the game out because it wasn't easy to get a hold of. It is for sure probably in our like... other than the like kind of like light fast party game collection, is probably one of our most played games.
Okay.
And it is a game that is, I think, a really, I mean, it's kind of the obvious to say that this is a like an industry, like a genre kind of breaking game where you get a lot of mainstream attention. But for what is a fairly complex game, it's a pretty easy teach.
Okay.
And so we have had a lot of folks. One of my favorite stories is we did a library event in rural Iowa that I was at the local bar. And I had a table of older middle-aged women who were a little inebriated, mm-hmm. who were like, we want to play the bird game. And we had to it took a little bit longer of a teach, but we're still able to get them through. And by the end of it, they were so confident in that game that one of them had ordered it while they were still finishing the game so they could get together every week and play. So Wyrmspan is a game that I have a lot of fondness for. Bigger picture stuff has done a lot of really interesting industry stuff.
For sure.
Which I adore and love. The hype around Wyrmspan has been really good. Having a copy from Early Access has been great. People have been really excited to see it out there. I think it's good to see kind of like an Azul, like an iteration of a concept, and people have been responding to it really well. I've got a couple of plays in. It is, it feels like it's maybe a little more intentional in the like combinations that you can kind of build up, and it feels like you can kind of step into that a little bit easier. You're not quite as victim to the randomness of what cards come up. Mm-hmm. One of my least favorite things in a game of Wyrmspan is when you're like, oh, I have like the hunting birds, but no one has the vulture mechanic. Mm-hmm. And like,
that's or like you need wests and norths, and those just never come up.
Right,
with the 200 card deck.
Right.
So real quick, do you have extra expansions for Wyrmspan in your collection? Or
we
just
do not. Okay. We're just playing the base. As much as I sometimes like to explore expansions for our events, an expansion makes it, you know, exponentially harder to learn a game, and we're generally speaking dealing with new folks. Wyrmspan has been just a ton of excitement and energy, which I always really like. The production quality on Wyrmspan is great. Less fiddly box stuff, which I like. Part of what I loved about Wyrmspan is that like how they have that print on how you put the game away mm-hmm. in the box, and they didn't do that with Wyrmspan, which is a bummer. But I love the upgraded coins. Like, those just feel good. I feel like they're almost essential at this point.
You got the whole upgraded
pack. I knew it was gonna, like, it's one of those games where it was gonna work with every penny because people are so excited to see it, and playing with the coins is great. In general, I like it quite a bit. As clean of a teach as Wyrmspan is. So we've had a lot of folks who are like, oh, I've never played Wyrmspan, still getting in. There's something really nice about being like, coins are generally your actions, and which means you're looking at approximately 18 decisions in this game.
Mm-hmm.
More than that. But like, it's sometimes you look at, like, if you haven't played a lot of bigger, like, modern games, you look at the whole board setup and you're like, I don't even know where to go. And to say, well, really, you're picking one of these three things each time. And then everything else kind of like cascades off of that. It really helps for folks who are maybe feeling a little bit of like, feeling a little overwhelmed to be able to say, oh, like this, really it's I'm doing this or I'm doing this or I'm doing this. And then like the benefits of doing those actions gets more as we go, but then you don't have to worry about like teaching all the little things because it's just going to come up on the cards.
Right. Okay.
Did you say you think it's Wyrmspan is harder to teach or easier to teach? I didn't catch that.
I think it's about the same.
Okay.
I think it's the same teach. I think it's a, as these things go, it's a pretty easy teach. Yeah. I've for sure got a pretty good patter for that game where I can just kind of like walk through and get you up and running. And for a game that is kind of that big and bitty, to have folks not feeling over, like you get that like blank stare sometimes when you do a teach and someone's like, oh, like they don't know what's going on now. And I don't get that with Wyrmspan. Like if someone's into some degree of modern games, they've got it with a quick teach pretty quickly.
Right. So what do you think of Wyrmspan?
I like it.
Okay.
It's not my favorite. Okay. I play Root with Cam through the app, and we have a chat. And so we all like randomly just dropped our top 10, Wyrmspan and Wyrmspan.
Not in
the top 10.
Yeah.
Like if I had to get rid of all but 10 of my games, it's not making the cut. But I think for a lot of folks, it is a really great mix of an interesting theme. I think it offers us, it's a really good gateway into a lot of other things that are happening in modern games. Not my favorite, though. I think I need to give you some boings.
Yeah, so we all went through our boings. Jake, Cam, Rob, they all gave it a 2. I gave it a 1. It was not a huge fan of it. 0 being the worst, 3 being the best. You clearly said it's not going to be your 4 boing game, so you can give a game a 4 boing one time, and you got one game. This is not it for you, right?
No, so, for sure not.
Okay. Think about it for a second. You know, if there's somewhere in that scale you want to hit it,
it's around 2.
Okay,
is it like 1.75? Can we get that fine of a detail? No, does that break
No, because I think Rob was a 2.25. I was probably like a 1.25, but like we both erred on the downside. So
yeah, I think I would give Wyrmspan 2, and I would give Wyrmspan slightly less.
Oh really?
Yeah, I mean I think my perspective is weird though.
Yeah, for
like
sure.
to be super clear, I have the weirdest board game perspective of anybody I know because I'm thinking about it from a like broad audience appeal. Right. And I don't think Wyrmspan will ever get as much play as Wyrmspan does. And I like what both of them do. I do see them kind of being different, but also part of me is like, could you have just made a completely different game? And because I don't know if there's enough added. Like, I think the average person, unless they're like a diehard, I don't think you need to own both.
Right. I would agree with that. Yeah. And for you, with the mass appeal and the people probably wanting it, it's definitely Wyrmspan.
Yeah.
I think generally the thought on the at our table was probably Wyrmspan as someone that's a little bit more into board gaming and it's a little bit more refined. The action selection is a little bit better, I think. Mm. But the hype and everything else, that's Wyrmspan for you.
Yeah. I think really like, especially when I think about like, if I have, so I have, you know, we're approaching 600 games in our working collection now and I can't take everything out every time. I think if I'm like, okay, it's approximately the same amount of box space in a tote. Once the hype winds down, it's probably going to be Wyrmspan going out to more events than Wyrmspan.
Yep. All right. That makes sense. Yeah.
I could be wrong.
We'll see.
It's for sure known to be happening.
Yeah, but now the hype is real. So
Now the hype is for sure real. Yeah. Absolutely.
You don't have multiple copies of anything.
No. Okay. Not of those games now. No.
Sweet. Anything else you want to add, Wyrmspan? Anybody? Cool. All right. Well, thank you on your thoughts on Wyrmspan. And then we're here to talk about a little Camp Refresh, too. You want to give us a kind of rundown of what that is, how you can sign up, all the good stuff?
Absolutely. Yeah. So Camp Refresh, high level, is a 3-day summer camp themed board game retreat that we are throwing at the Y Camp, the Des Moines Y Camp in Boone, which is a confusing thing because it's the Des Moines Y Camp, but it's like nowhere near Des Moines. Yeah, 45 minutes away. We'll give the short history. So Delt Hand launched to be kind of market testing to open a board game bar in Des Moines. Still want to do that someday. Market's not right for it right now. Committing to a 5-year commercial lease with everything is yikes. But Mary and I, my wife, who the other owner of the Delt Hand, both kind of came up through summer camps. We actually met at camp. It's really gross. I'm sorry. But we've always loved camp. We love being outdoors. We love hiking. We're doing that sort of stuff. And then we love games. And so we were like, well, what's a way that we can still do something that is a way to expand and grow and keep doing Delt Hand stuff that doesn't involve us kind of going down this brick and mortar route? And through a lot of conversations with folks and kind of a fusion of good ideas, we landed on Camp Refresh, a way to do kind of a board game convention feel, with a little less of a pressure and intensity, you know, Cardboard Caucus, now Capital City Gaming Convention, has been great. They have been doing a wonderful job where we love doing stuff with them. But every time I'm there, it gets to a certain point during the weekend where I'm like, there are so many people in one room right now and it's so loud and I just, and so one of the things we wanted to be able to do is like, hey, what can we do to create a space that is, spacious and you can still do all these things. You can still play games with people you want to hang out with, but also have a chance to kind of unwind and not feel like there's so much pressure going on. So Camp Refresh is really built to be, so it's 3 days. So it's noon Friday through Sunday, 3 p.m. And we're going to be, playing games. We're going to have our full Delt Hand collection out there. But also we're going to do all the camp stuff. So we're going to be able to do, you know, the Y Camp has, archery and climbing wall. They've got canoeing that we're going to be able to offer. But you can also do a campfire story game or go for a hike or do some crafts. And so you can do a little bit of games, take a break and do something outside, and then come back and do more of that. We also really wanted to build a couple of important things in terms of pricing. So our pricing is all-inclusive. So everything we do all weekend is just your flat ticket price. We're going to be using Meeple Meet, which is the board game convention app that's used at Geekway, to power a lot of that sort of stuff. So you can just sign up for activities and kind of build that schedule out that way. And then we're going to be able to just do a lot of surprises. There's a lot of things that I want to talk about desperately, but I'm very bad at secrets. So I just have to have, there's like this list of things that I have written down that I've been told I may not talk about. And they're the coolest things.
For Mary.
Yeah. The folks we've got helping us put together, they're like, Joe, you can't talk about this or this or this, period. When we get there, it's going to be great. But until then, I just have to not tell you about beep. just like, ugh. I was like, right. I'm just like, there's, it's cool. Anyway, we've had a lot of other fun things too. So one of the other pieces of feedback we've gotten from folks is child activities and specifically child care programming. And that's a weird and hard space to operate in, but we wanted to honor those requests and do that. So one of the things that we've got coming on, one of the librarians that we work with at the Norwalk Library has developed programming for kids up to age 18. So you can, if you've got a family that wants to come out to camp, maybe the kids middle of the afternoon want something a little bit different than sitting around for another round of board games. Catherine has this whole slew of great activities. Tim Ferry from Board Game Builders is doing the board game design class Saturday afternoon for all the kids. So the older kids will make a game while they're at camp. And all this sort of stuff we can just kind of build in and do and not have to worry about that costing extra. The other thing, and we haven't talked about this publicly yet, but we went to our Patreons yesterday, and we'll be posting early next week, is that we're going to also start offering day passes. So for folks who can't commit to a full weekend but still want to come out and get some of that Camp Refresh experience, we'll be able to start doing that. So you can come at 9 o'clock Saturday morning, hang out, have lunch, have dinner, still do all the activities, and then just not sleep at camp or don't let me know you're sleeping at camp. Right. And so you can still kind of have that full experience, but not have to, you know, sleep in a weird cabin or anything like that. Though I will say their cabins are super nice. Yeah. Like I've seen, I walked through a bunch of camps. They have very nice cabins.
It's not a bunk with 30 beds and
thin mattresses and that kind of thing? Or yeah.
I mean, so that like they're
still bunks, right?
But they're still bunks, and so like they're halls, but they are like climate controlled and clean and pretty, and like they're for the most part very nice bunks. But it's still, I mean, it's not like a hotel room, so.
Right? Yeah, but it's not your typical camp.
It's not a murder cabin. Yeah, it's not a murder cabin. Yeah. They've got a couple of those, and we're gonna do some scary games in the murder cabins, but no one's sleeping in them.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so both me and my kid are coming. If there's day passes open, I might try to talk the wife into coming on Saturday. I think, you know, you and Bo are coming. Rob and Bo are coming.
We're bunking.
Yeah, we're bunking together, so it'll be a good time. And then, we're super excited about it. I think it's gonna be great.
Yeah, we're so excited. We're 5 weeks out. We're at the point where I am resisting the urge to look at extended forecasts because late April in Iowa might be beautiful or it might be I have to shovel. And I'm really hoping it's more of the former than the latter.
Hopefully it's getting its out of its system right now since we just had a little snow.
Yeah. Let's get it all shaken out. One of the things I really want to be able to do, they have a cabin that has got some water damage, so they just ripped on the walls and they have it screened in. So it's a screened in porch.
Yeah.
But it also has a huge stone fireplace. And all I want to do is like Friday night after everything else is done and play a game inside outside by the fireplace. And like if I get that one thing, like everything else is gonna be gravy for me.
Yeah. Sounds awesome.
Yeah. So I'm super excited. And really like we get the first one done, and it's gonna be so much easier to start talking about like what the future events look like. We've gotten some feedback and some ideas for future stuff, maybe doing an adults one. One of the things that I can't do is I can't do like cocktails or anything like that.
Yeah, makes sense.
Part of me was like happy hour would be fun, but insurance, I guess. Yeah.
The Deltand Des Moines River cruise.
Oh man.
a Deltand float trip.
Write that down. but actually, so one of the things that we are thinking about doing is having a kind of like almost like an alumni program. So like you've been to camp once and doing little weird one-off events like throughout the year afterwards. If you've been to camp once, we're gonna do an outside activity at a different camp someplace else for, you know, we're gonna go down to Walnut Woods and rent a cabin out and have day activities out there and stuff like that. So we're thinking about some of those longer term things too, because there is this nice overlap. Like nature themed board games have been around for a long time because there's a lot of folks who are really excited about those sorts of things too. So we're definitely looking to explore some more of that sort of stuff, but I got to get the first thing done because
I can only imagine like, so as someone that's kind of, you know, been a part of like, I'm liking this too, like scheduling a work event or like scheduling a bunch of people and, you know, aligning all those things. Like, I can't even imagine how, you know, how much effort that these kind of things go. And so thank you for doing that. That's awesome. Yeah,
it's great. I'm getting very good at spreadsheets, but it has been we like logistical puzzles because we like board games.
Right.
So this is part of me is like, this is just scratching a slightly more terrifying version of a logistical board game puzzle. But it has been, it's been a really, like, it's a learning process and there's a lot of interesting things, but also like part of what I love about what we get to do with the hand is that we get to meet people who are excited about events, and the people who are excited about this are like foaming at the mouth.
Yeah.
And like, I feed off of that energy too, which is helpful.
Good. So how do people find out more information or sign up?
All right, so camprefresh.com. Everything is on the website there. You can also go to our socials, Camp Refresh Iowa, I think is the Instagram, Camp Refresh. Everything's also linked off of the Delt Hand website.
Okay.
The full weekend pass is $300. I am going to hook you all up with the with a discount code.
Ooh, all right.
So if you use the discount code No Mo FOMO, N O M O F O M O. Like,
I love it.
Yeah. So that'll take $25 off your order.
Awesome.
Day passes are available by the time this goes out. It'll be just linked on the sites normally. Day passes will be $80. All passes, all inclusive, food, lodging. If you're doing the full weekend pass, the Saturday pass includes two meals. The Y camp is set up to meet any dietary restrictions. So vegetarian, food allergies, no big deal. Just let us know when you complete your ticket, and then they will take care of you that way.
No mo fo mo. And
come and check it out.
Real quick, one other thing. Speaking of the $25 discount, you did something I thought was pretty cool. You did a like where you could donate more money.
Absolutely.
When you bought your ticket, there was a place to donate more money, which basically you took that money and then you've kind of helped.
We have a half dozen people who are coming to camp that couldn't have otherwise afforded because of the generosity of the folks who are buying their tickets. So the Helping Hand Fund still exists. We still have a couple of folks that we'd like to be able to get there, but we have a handful of folks who are coming to camp that, life gets expensive, and an expensive weekend is the sort of thing that people chipping in $5 or $10 here or there has made a huge difference, and is one of those things that just like. You didn't have to do, but it warms the cockles of my heart to know that like people are willing to help out and make sure that other folks can come and be part of it too.
Sweet. Okay. So camprefresh.com.
Camprefresh.com. Discount code NOMO FOMO.
And we'll have Cam put the link and stuff in the description of the podcast too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sweet. Yeah. Joe, anything else? Anything else you want to plug? When's your next event?
So the next big thing that we want to tell folks about, obviously we're super excited for camp, but due to popular demand, we're bringing back the board game Sail and Swap. We're doing it at a different location. We are going to be at the New Northwestern is a cocktail bar in the East Village. We do our Thursday nights are there, so every Thursday we're out there, but they're going to open up on Sunday for us. One of the nice things is that it's an entirely indoor space, so you can not have to feel weird about being out in a parking lot. Mm-hmm. So we have two floors. It's a beautiful lobby. They're going to have a revamped menu, so that way it'll be appropriate for kids to be in a cocktail bar on a Sunday. But we'll still have great drinks as well. And then we also have some friends of ours who own the Best Spuds food truck.
Okay.
So potato-based, so baked potatoes and fried potatoes and stuff like that, and just A-plus food truck. So food and drinks and super good deals on board games. All that should be on our Facebook. Then there should be links to those events also through the Adult Hand website. You can kind of scroll through upcoming events there if you don't do Facebook, because I wouldn't blame you if you didn't.
Totally get it. Cool. All right. Well, thank you, Joe. We appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing you at the events.
Yeah. Thanks.
All right, well, are we ready to get on to some final thoughts then?
Sure.
Tim, you might as well go first.
I basically gave them.
Yeah,
like, I think... So I used to like Wyrmspan. I have both... I don't have the Asia expansion. I think generally they made the game worse for the most part. This one I feel about the same way as I feel with the expansions. Like, I think it's fine. Do you want to talk about the Boeing scale before I give my rating?
Yeah, we probably should.
Okay.
Here on the Board Boys podcast, we have a 4 Boeing rating scale, 3 Boeing rating scale. 3.
That was
a Freudian slip.
Are you going to give me like predicting the future for this episode? Is that?
Then I'm going to give it a 4 Boeing.
You're going to 4 Boeing this thing?
Rob threatened a 4 Boeing last episode.
I know. I mean, like, when am I ever going to do it? I probably should just pull the trigger. When am I going to play like a new game that I'm like, "Oh my god, this is the game." Maybe never. 0 is the worst. 3 is the best. If it's Cam, you'll give it a 2.
Realistically, can we just say 0.5 is the worst? Because nobody's ever going to give a game that we review a 0, right?
I don't know. Tim over there.
I don't think I'd even probably give a game a 0.5 ever.
I think
1 is my lowest score.
I think 1 is probably the lowest I would ever give.
Well, it's only a 6-point scale, so I don't think you could give it a 0. So 0.5 probably is it. Campbell, why don't you give us a 1 or a 0.5 and 3 Boeing game of Wyrmspan?
Okay, so a 1 Boeing game of Wyrmspan.
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 Sorry.
Wyrmspan. Is when you go into the cave and there's only one cavern and you can only have one dragon. And the dragon you get
is Falcor.
it's Falcor. 3 Boeing game of Wyrmspan is when Cam is taking double the heart medicine, where both of his glasses and takes like 1 minute turn, so the game is done in an hour. Because that's kind of where I feel like I'd like this game a lot more, is if it was faster, and I know I'm a part of that. So
I do not believe it was the two of yours' fault. I just think it's just how the game plays. Is that
I don't think I like sat and like waffled on stuff for a long time, but I was like, kind of learning the order I needed to do things in, kind of in real time. So.
In the second round, I was mega stuck with not being able to get cards, and I definitely took some time trying to figure out the way to do that, for sure.
3-point game of Wyrmspan takes 1 hour. That's my 3-point one.
All right.
Which
so,
I could never happen with Wyrmspan, by the way. Ever.
Yeah, I don't think so. Maybe with like 2 or 3 players.
Like, I think this game has
the potential to be much faster.
Yeah,
I agree. Whether it does or not is a different thing, but I think it could.
All right. Well, I'm waffling on what I'm going to give it, but I think I'm going to give it a 1. Like, I do not love this game. Like,
I could tell.
Yeah. Like,
or while we were playing, I could just tell the disinterest.
I mean, it's fine. It's just like, I know what I'm going to do. There's not much to think about. And that was it. So it was just like, I'll do it and then move on, you know.
Is that you're going to leave it at that?
I think I'm going to leave it
at that. I'm going to go next because I think I'm going to give it the second lowest score out of everybody. So I think that if I played this game in perpetuity, I would enjoy it more than Wyrmspan. Time will tell, and I like Wyrmspan. As far as the cultural impact of Wyrmspan versus Wyrmspan, I don't really see the need for another game that's pretty much exactly the same.
I agree with that.
Now, it's too late to replace Wyrmspan with Wyrmspan.
They basically did it with Asia, too. Like, Asia is like almost a wholly new game.
Well, it just adds a 2-player.
Yeah, but like, it's not just adds
like
a
2-player. It
just adds more cards, but other than that, it adds a whole new module, like a dual component, like a lot of games were making.
It's a whole new board and all kinds. I mean,
for the dual, yeah,
sure.
Like, if you look at recent games, like From Stonemaier, we just had, what's the name? Like, the game's called Expeditions or whatever, which is like a retelling of like the way Scythe plays, but it's a different game. You know, we've been super into Pirates of Maracaibo, which is similar to Maracaibo but not the same. Like, this game I think is too close for me to be like so zazzed on it that I run out and get it. Now, I'm not the Wyrmspan all-time fan though, so like, I like Wyrmspan. I think like this game's like a definite for people who enjoy Wyrmspan. But I don't see it being like eclipsing Wyrmspan, even though it may be better. So I don't know, 2 boinks. I like it. I'd play it again. Maybe I play it 5 more times and I come back and I go, guys, I was really wrong. This game's the bomb. So that could happen. But I think it'd stay a 2 for me, probably. That's my thoughts right now.
I can go next. I think that I want to kind of build on something Cam said. I think if you are somebody who Wyrmspan is your favorite game, that definitely get this game. Like
I agree with that.
It's different enough that you get to live in what you really enjoy a ton. So I do think it has a place for that. And I just am not somebody who it's frustrated or angry about the fact that people are making similar games to things. Like, if that isn't your interest, then that's not for you, and that's fine. But most games aren't for everybody, so it just may not appeal to you, and that's fine. That doesn't mean it isn't a good home somewhere else.
Well, I agree with you, and I think most of the time, like, I love Marco Polo 2, even though it's pretty similar to Marco Polo 1. It's like more of the same, but it's like more. This one for me, so much of the punch of Wyrmspan is the cultural impact, which, you know, because, like, again, it's not really I'm not super zazzed about it. I just don't see this being like having that, you know, like, I don't see Wyrmspan replacing Wyrmspan. But like, if one of my friends was like, hey Cam, I'm thinking about getting this game Wyrmspan, you know, for us and the kids, I would probably go like, hey, you should look at Wyrmspan too, because I just played that and like, I think it fixes, like, not fixes, but like, I think it does like more things better. But overall, like, in the industry, like, what's the legacy? I think it's still Wyrmspan by a lot.
I don't disagree with that at all. I definitely think I enjoy playing this more, and I think a lot of that has to do with what I alluded to earlier in the pros, that just turns feel better for the most part. I do get a lot of enjoyment out of the way turns work too, with the coins and being able to add more and work through that. That being said, it's still not my favorite type of game. It's a game that if somebody's like, do you want to play Wyrmspan or Wyrmspan, I would definitely choose Wyrmspan, and I would have a continual interest in playing this, because I think there are lots of different ways to get to your end result, and I think that that is an enjoyable experience for me. But it's a 2 for me as well. It's not a game that I would say I really like, but I do enjoy it, and I'd be happy to play it.
One more thing to add on to that, with you and me being like, it's not really my game. When I think about how many people I hear in the last couple of years say, like, I love Furnace, which to me was like so meh. Maybe there is like a space for a Wyrmspan to be like huge, because I think maybe that's an area where like I'm underrepresenting the amount of people who love like tableau building and like the engine creation.
There's a lot of that out there.
Yeah, and like Furnace hits so hard for people, and I like to me like that's a similar game to these games, you know.
Did it?
Yeah, like I've heard, well, I think I've seen Furnace on so many top lists from the last couple of years.
I mean, but
to me, it was just like a filler almost.
It is,
but like I don't think a lot of people saw it that way.
Yeah, it's like
which was like a was
the most
weird to
pure
me.
Engine build. Like, yeah, exactly. That's literally all it is. It's inputs and outputs, and that's it. For me, I'm a person that I own everything for Wyrmspan. I have the stupid nesting box, and ever since I put the stuff in there, I've never got it out. I have expansions. I've never played for it. Wyrmspan and Wyrmspan are probably a max for the most part. I mean, if you want to like just chill with your friends, like sure, 4 players, but like they probably both excel as a 2-3 player game. Honestly, I mean, like if you want to play them faster or a solo game, like these are both. I think I've had maybe not the most fun because I like playing with other people, but out of any solo game experience that I've ever had, this one might be one of the most enjoyable ones because you're just like, I enjoy the tableau building and doing the thing, but guess what? It's always your turn. So like, that's cool. I definitely see why they say like best at 3. I could definitely get down with that. I don't know that I've played it at 3 yet. Maybe once. I played this game close to 10 times now, I think, between solo and with people. If I went out to the store right now and didn't own this or Wyrmspan, 100% get Wyrmspan over Wyrmspan, unless you love birds. Like, unless you're like a ornithologist, is that the right word? Or like you're into bird watching.
Only if you're an amateur. Ornithologist.
Is an amateur.
No degree required.
Yeah, there you go. The stuff that they did with this game just make it more fun and intriguing, I believe. All that being said, I think I'm going to give it a 2 as well. Like, because this isn't like my jam either. Like, I'd probably give it a 2.25 if I could. I think 2.5 is just a little too much. I'm right in between. I'm gonna cow to the 2 though and hang out right there. It's going to stay in my collection. I got to decide whether or not I'm going to offload all that Wyrmspan now though. It makes me kind of want to go back and try Wyrmspan again. I haven't done it since I played a bunch of Wyrmspan. But it's play every game in my collection year. So time to play it and see what happens.
Or get rid of it.
Because then I can just keep this nice smaller Wyrmspan box until they release all the expansions for that. And then the cave box.
Yeah, I was just going to say cave box.
For your dragons.
The cave box.
All right, cool. So I think that wraps us up for Wyrmspan. Here on the Board Boys podcast, we look back a year in the past at what we reviewed then. I like to call it the bumper dump. Cam, hit us.
Baby, turn around. I want to see that taxi.
Or dump.
All right. 1 year ago was Revive. Revive. Revive was an 8.2 for a ranking of 1032. Has it gone up or down in the rankings?
Up.
Bump.
Bump.
Boom.
It's gone way up, dude. It's 118.
Yo.
Ooh, it's almost in the top 100.
I'm actually a little surprised at how high it is.
Yeah, 118.
I think it's a clear going to be a top 100 if it's that high already.
Yeah. You think so?
I think so.
64 strategy. So
we'll see.
Yeah.
It'll keep going up.
Okay.
We just played it 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
It was tight. The expansion's good.
We played with the expansion. Yeah.
What is
the
it? /add.
So the expansion adds a whole new point track that also has like one of those end game scoring tiles in it and the ability to draw these. I forget how you even pronounce the name of this card, but there's a whole new card deck that are just really sweet cards. And when you get to a spot on that track, you get to draw two and pick one. And they're any color you want when you play them. And then their abilities are just like super fun and cool. And then at the end of the game, or anytime you score points, you can either, you can trade your, I'm going to forget the names. You're either going to trade your vanilla regular VP at a 2-for-1 ratio for these new cool dark points, or you can do vice versa. But at the end of the game, you just add both those tracks together, and that's like your final score. That's like the majority of what's added. There's more factions, more tiles. There's those like adventures you can go on, yeah, where like you can take these cards by discarding a card, and then when you have the objective completed, you flip it and you get some stuff. There's some more, and then there's just like more stuff, like more machines. There's these cool, really powerful machines that go on your board that work one time and explode. You just like flip them over and they're gone. It's a real easy expansion to add in, except for, you know, understanding the different factions and what they do kind of a thing. But there's nothing like super crazy there either. I have not played Revive. I wanted to play it solo before this. I think the solo is really easy to play in this game too. So I'm probably going to play that, and maybe I'll talk about it in a future cast. I freaking love Revive.
Yeah, me
it's
too.
If I didn't three boing it before, it's a three.
I'm just feeling really bad about how few board games I've played in the last year, baby related. But I'm like, I haven't even unwrapped my copy of Revive that we had to like try to get.
Yeah.
And now you have the expansion.
Revive.
It makes me want to cry.
Revive for Rob was a 2.
Whoa, really?
Yeah, that's what it says.
It's a 3. Revive is, I really like it. It's the game that I own that might look the most complicated that I think is the most straightforward.
I have really mixed feelings about Revive. I really like a ton of it. I really like the actions, the deck building component, the moving, you know, what's the thing called where you're moving all your different colors,
like the machine?
Yeah, well, like the tracks.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's a ton of fun. But I just hate the endgame scoring. I really don't like the alien heads and the fact that the things that you're aligning to
could just happen
to be the same color. I really dislike that.
There are two things that they added that are variants. One is everyone scores the same endgame scorecard, and it's public, so everyone's shooting for the same things. We played with that. Yep. I think I like that better than the hidden one. And two, every time you take a machine, you blow up one more machine. It's like you dig through the machine stack faster.
Yep.
So even if you don't have the expansion, those are two things. You can play your base Revive, and I think they both make the game... Depends if you like the secret hidden scoring objective or not, but... you might like the one where everyone's shooting.
I want to try that.
At least you know what everyone's going for, right?
Nobody else has that problem other than me, though, for the endgame scoring of the original.
No, but...
Not really.
Okay. I really don't like that component of it, but the rest of the game I really like. So the factions, the unique tech you can get for those, I think there's a ton to like. That has always rubbed me the wrong way. So I would like to try it without that being the way that it works.
Cool. If you want to give us feedback on the Bumper Dump, you can at our Board Game Geek Guild. You can find that at the website. So we got a bunch here. BJ from Board Game Gumbo says, Revive is better with each play. You want combo wombos? Check. Clever card play? Check. Crawfish etouffee served over a bed of rice? Sorry, that doesn't come with it. But it included. But is included as a short campaign that dribbles out the tweaks of the rules to make each game more fun. Easy three boings for him. He said he'd give it 4.5, but Rob will just edit it out anyway. Teresa Aachen, this is a new commenter here. She's only played it once, but it's a 2-boinger. Christopher Boat says 2.5 when played with the expansion. Jeremy Thoman, 2.5 boings. He only played it once, but it was with the expansion. Nate Simmons. At the end, you all reviewed this. I had no concept of what the game was. Since then, I've had an opportunity to play it and absolutely loved it. Only got to play it one time, would definitely jump at the chance to do it again. 2 boings. So, please give us some feedback on this. The bumper dumps that are coming up are Marrakesh, Beast, and Atiwa.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. I think I have most of those out there. If not, I will get more out there soon. Well, thanks for listening to another episode of the Board Boys podcast. Season 14, episode 5.
Season 14, episode 5.
Wyrmspan. Check out theboardboys.com for all your cool Board Boys links. From there, you can get to the Discord. You can go support our Patreon. You can go check all of our social medias, all the cool pictures and things we post out there. Play some BGA games with us. Find that channel on the Discord. Campbell's always hitting that up real hard.
I play so much BGA because I don't get to go play real board games right now.
Mm-hmm.
Except today. And other times we record this podcast. And hopefully one of these days very soon I'll be back to Tuesdays.
And there'll be a party for the world?
And yeah, very soon. You know, it's time. Like, I love Steve Walsh, but I think it's... We've been leaning pretty hard on Steve Walsh for like five seasons now. I think it's time I found a new weird guy.
But Boing 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 is attached
boing,
to him.
Boing,
that's our whole scale.
We'll never stop Boing Boing Boing.
Oh, I thought we were going to get a whole new scale.
No.
I got mad.
Maybe one day. But yeah.
We'll develop an exchange
the
rate.
Dragon the dragon version, of Steve Walsh. Yeah.
And speaking of our patrons, I'd like to thank Hammond Buckland, BJ from Board Game Gumbo, Shifty Teeth, Jeff Gray, Andre Bosch, Braden Dowdy, Rob Cooper, Richard Lane, Matt Kelly, and Jeremy Thoman. And lastly, I hope you like board games.
And very soon there will be a party for the world, thanks to Steve Walsh.
Until
DJ Steve
Cam
Walsh.
Changes it and it's no longer Steve.
Until I find a new weird guy. Boing, boing, boing. We'll be right back.